Welcome to season two of the Religion Punk. I'm very excited to actually say that. I feel like we've really come a long way getting to season two, and here we are starting over. My name is Beth, and I'm here with my co-host, Dr. Darf. This season, we'll be studying the book of the Revelation, and to start that conversation, let's open up with a brief introduction to eschatology. The word is just as complicated as its definition, but basically eschatology is a theological study concerned with last things, death and resurrection, the last judgment, and the final days, commonly known as the end times or the end of the world. You can even say it's the study of the end times. And I think that this is even more appropriate to do this chapter than it was originally, now that we're, in year two of the pandemic. And I think a lot of people are really starting to think, is this really the end times? Are we getting into the end times? But Dr. Darf, could you tell us a little more about the topic of eschatology?
Well, again, I think we give pretty much a technical definition. The study of in the last days, end times, death, resurrection, all of that kind of fits into that study. And again, I think this is probably very much on people's minds today, which I don't think we're going to be here to make any great revelation predictions as to the end of the world. And we're not going to be in the process of giving any dates of when we think that that's going to happen or anything. But But there are a lot of scary things happening in the world around us. And COVID-19 and how we've been locked down, you know, for the last 2 years, two plus years. And we've seen thousands of churches in America close because they've lost their congregations, or they got down to few in numbers where they could no longer, you know, keep their churches going. And with people trying to refigure how to do church, you know, what that means to, is it safe for me to go to church? Can I go and be a part of some kind of a study at home? Or can I listen to this podcast, you know, and call that my church? You know,
absolutely.
That's just kind of where we're at. And as we open with the topic, you know, we're going to be working with, you know, different theories, and or some might call it schools of interpretation. These are some basic ones that, and I know there's a whole lot of others, but, you know, there is the spiritualist who believe that the book of Revelation is mostly a spiritual book. It's not necessarily designed to teach future events, but rather demonstrates a spiritual struggle of God's people in the world. And with that group, some people would even say that the book is worshipful and that it, you know, teaches us lessons on how to worship. Then there's preterists who believe the events described in the book of Revelation are events that have already occurred, mainly during the first century. And that would go back to the time of Paul and the persecutions under Emperor Nero. And so there's a lot of, you know, the history of Rome in there. And the historicist typically interprets the book as allegory that reflects the entire church age. Oh, and then we have a futurist category that typically interprets the book as being a futuristic prophecy that's yet to be fulfilled. And I guess that's kind of really where I've always kind of believed. I think for me, the book of the Revelation is somewhat circular in the sense that it kind of cycles with history, you know, as history cycles. And I forget the person that once mentioned, you know, that those that do not know history, you know, are doomed to repeat it. I'm sure you've heard something to that effect anyway. But there are people, you know, that in various times in history who have believed to be living in the end times. Just like if you go back to a few centuries ago, there were people that looked to the Roman Catholic Church and the Pope as being the Antichrist. And obviously, time went on and the Pope didn't prove out to be the Antichrist. So there again, people have wondered, well, during the times of World War II with Adolf Hitler, and wondering, you know, what the outcome of that was going to be like, and maybe even wondering if Hitler was some kind of a form of the Antichrist. You would have to say with Hitler, he was an Antichrist, as there are Antichrists today. As in, I believe in the Epistle of John, it mentions the spirit of Antichrist. So an Antichrist is basically someone who is against Christ, you know, very much a God hater. They're just opposite, opposed to Christ would be Antichrist. And so the world is full of Antichrists today. Now, as far as the one that people will hold to futuristic prophecy, that there will be a world ruler that will rise up in power, there again, it's a scary thing to think about, not impossible. But again, as we watch countries coming together and relationships and technology and the growing world population is almost to the point of getting close to 8 billion people. There's a lot of the problems we have going on now in America with the economy and with food shortages and fuel shortages and different opinions on what kind of fuel we should use and what kind of fuel we shouldn't use. And, you know, what kind of fuel is pollution and what is clean air? And I mean, what is renewable energy? I mean, when you start adding in all of these things into the equation, it's like you've got so many mathematical problems that you've written on the board that you don't even have enough room to be able to solve those problems. So here we are as we begin the study of the book of the Revelation.
Yeah, and as you start listing all this stuff out, I mean, that's like a trailer for this entire episode. Very uplifting. I mean, it really puts things in perspective when you start listing all the things that are going wrong. I almost feel like we should turn around and say some of the things that are going right, just to kind of counterbalance that.
Which is?
I know. Right. Which is, we're alive.
Another note that I had here, Russell Boatman, who is Dean Emeritus of St. Louis Christian College, or I guess used to be, adds to the list of theories in the end time, what does the Bible say, including premillennialism, where Christ will return prior to the millennium, the postmillennialism, where Christ will return after the millennium, and the amillennialism, which looks at the return of Christ. In this text, Boatman appears quite negative towards the premillennialist and the postmillennialist theories, saying that premillennialism depends on an ensuing or imminent world crisis for its credence and popular appeal. Postmillennialism requires an extending period of peace and progress for its credibility. Amillennialists, better called church age millennialists, avoid speculative systems. I almost just think a person could just start out with the millennial thing and just say that as fast as you could, you know, and how many times could you say that in 60 seconds without messing up, you know?
Yeah, well, take some millennial to really get those.
kind of a mouthful there anyway.
Yeah.
His point being that one should not look at a particular world crisis and assume that the end of the world is at hand. And I think that's a safe way of approach, because there's just been too many people that have made predictions and have embarrassed themselves or embarrassed their following by being wrong, you know, by saying, well, the world was going to end in 1974, 1975, or 2000, or whenever. So, you know, I can understand the reservation to not get caught up in trying to predict some kind of a theory, because really this, when it comes down to what is going to happen, it's really in God's hands and according to God's timetable. But in today's society, it's difficult to envision a time where the world will be dominated by a Christian faith but rather the opposite. In this 21st century, there's even a greater temptation to see a world that is more dominated by evil. And therefore, while studying the book of the Revelation, we should avoid speculative theories and focus directly on what the Bible says, especially when the Bible itself is its own best interpreter. Which case, this does not mean that we ignore the theories presented. Instead, our lives should be prepared to follow Christ wherever that journey takes us. It's like a song that many of people my age learned in our Sunday school years. You know, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Well, as we begin to study the book of the Revelation, we need to look at the title of the book itself. The book of the Revelation is the revelation of Jesus Christ. The revelation is both from Christ and about Christ. And in John chapter 1, verse 18 says, Christ is the revelation of God himself. God gave the revelation to Christ to be shown to John by means of an angel or a messenger. And in the book of the Revelation, it is written, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, things which must shortly take place, and he sent and signified it by his angels to his servant. The word servant might be a little bit flimsy because the Greek word means a slave. A slave is going to be a stronger connection than a servant. Servants are people that one hires. Slaves are bound, closely connected. And then John says, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ to all things that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the word of his prophecy, of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. And I think that little Greek side note was one of yours.
That was something actually this just recently I've started just reading again. I mean, it's one of these things that, you know, we got a whole new year, you know, 2022. Again, we've got all of these things that are happening. A new opportunity, of course, to study the book again. And I've also got a new translation of the Bible that I'm working with, which is the Christian Standard Bible that used to be what they called the Holman Christian Standard Bible. And I like to, every time I study the Bible and read through the Bible, I usually pick a different translation, like the New International Version or the Christian Standard Bible or the New King James Version, King James Version, Living Bible, New Living Translation. I mean, there's a whole bunch of others, but usually I try to pick a different one. But I noticed just in reading this, that word doulos that is used here, that is the Greek word, and it means a slave. And the problem is, slave is not a good word to use in today's context because of the negativity, because to some people the word slave is offensive, you know. So even within the Christian faith and even in some of the modern translations of scriptures, instead of using the word a slave, they said servant. But servant is a little bit not quite as connected, I mean, as a slave. A servant is somebody that's usually you think of for hire, and they put in their 8 or 10 hours a day, and then they go home, and, you know, their time is their own. But the writers of the scriptures, especially the Apostle Paul, uses the word doulos, a slave, because a slave is bound. And that is the committedness that Paul and, well, John, who wrote the book of the Revelation, they want to emphasize that bond. They are a bond servant, that they're saying that the completeness of their life belongs to God, belongs to the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're not concerned about having the free time to live their life and have their own ideals and dreams, and which there again, it's highly discouraging to probably a lot of people today, that especially people coming to America, you know, they want to fulfill the American dream, so to speak. But you know, when you look at this life that God has given to us, if you're an atheist and you believe that all that there is to this life is just the here and now, then I guess you better have your dream and go out there and make it come true. And because when you get to the end of your life or whatever, the switch is turned off and you are no more, you exist no more. But for those of us that believe in eternal life with Jesus Christ, our Lord, we're very serious about the idea that so I give up 70 years of my life and consider myself to be a slave. You know, that is nothing compared to eternal life, you know, with Jesus Christ. I guess it comes down to, okay, who's being selfish here? You know, is it the person, you know, that's trying to hang on to every breath of their life, or is it the person that's willing to give up their life and to give it up for God because they know that there's a better life coming? And you got to also have that vision as you're approaching this book, the study of the book, the Revelation. You've got to remember that in the back of the book, we're talking about eternity and eternal life and spending time with God. And if you're not prepared to look at any of that or see that as the big picture, the final chapter, however way you want to view it, then probably not going to get a whole lot about reading the book of the Revelation, unless you just want to read about a bunch of beasts and monsters and Jurassic Park. You know, this is Jurassic Park at its worst, you know, the book of the Revelation. And there are people, you know, that have pretty much dismissed the writings of the Bible as being more like myth and fable and stories and so forth. And these are not just, you know, these are people, you know, that have theological educations, but still it doesn't mean that just because you have a PhD in theology does not mean that you believe it or believe any of it. And for some of the people that are even teaching, you know, in our universities and seminaries, to look at the book of Revelation, they see it as simply, it's apocalyptic literature, meaning that it is like the science fiction of its time. You know, this is the Star Wars, you know, the Star Trek, and I'm sure you can fill in some more modern ones other than what I'm giving. But those people reduce all of this as just a type or a genre of literature. And then you might pick up another book to where someone says, no, this is the Bible. This is the inspired word of God. And these words do contain prophecy. And it is simply up for us to try to differentiate and discern which of this is fact, or has the possibility of being factual. We had looked at one time, our study, you know, being mostly over the book of Revelation, it's suspected that many Christians are not aware that there are other writings outside the Bible that were judged apocalyptic literature. And you kind of have to throw this in because this is where your skeptics come in, especially if you are a what you might consider yourself a Bible-believing Christian, and someone comes up and they say, well, what about the other books of the Bible? Well, most Christians are going to say, well, I didn't know there were any other books of the Bible. It says, oh, yeah, there's other books of the Bible. You know, there's a Apocalypse of Peter, you know, or the Gospel of Mary. There was a fragment, Akmim fragment, that talks about many of them shall be false prophets, shall teach ways and diverse doctrines of perdition. They shall become sons of perdition, and then shall God come unto my faithful ones that hunger and thirst and are afflicted and prove their souls in this life and shall judge the sons of iniquity. And then in verse 23 of that document, there was a great lake full of flaming mire, wherein there were certain men that turned away from the righteousness, and angels, tormentors, were set over them. And there were also others, women hang by their hair above that mire, which boiled up, and these were they that adorned themselves for adultery. And the men that were joined with them in the defilement of adultery were hanging by their feet and had their heads hidden in the mire, and said, we believe not that we should come unto this place. And I saw the murderers of them that were consenting to them cast into a strait place full of evil creeping things, and smitten by those beasts, and so turning themselves about in that torment. And upon them were set worms like clouds of darkness, and the souls of them that murdered stood and looked upon the torment of those murderers and said, O God, righteous is thy judgment. And then I'm just skipping down to verse 27, I think. And other men and women were being burned up to their middle and cast down in the dark place of scourged by evil spirits, and having their entrails devoured by worms and rested not. And these were they that had persecuted the righteous and delivered them up. To kind of go on and on and on, which we don't want to go on and on and on, but it's almost like some of these writings that are outside of the Bible are even worse than the book of Revelation, you know, when it comes to describing, you know, the torments of, that are going to take place. But again, as they kind of try to throw those other books of the Bible, those other works, what they would call scripture, as they try to throw that into the pile, it simply tries to confuse people from, you know, trying to say this is the book of the Revelation, this is God's word, and I'm going to accept what God says.
Well, and as I read that, I mean, that's a really descriptive and disturbing document. I don't know if you watch any supernatural kind of shows, but there's a show called Salem that kind of is a historical fiction version of the Salem witch trials. I don't remember what channel it's on, but this document here reminds me very much of scenes in that show. And it's very disturbing where they are like boiling people alive in like this gooey. I mean, it's creepy. I'll have to like link to certain parts of it in this episode, because as I'm reading that, I'm thinking, oh man, I've seen this. And for this to be something that people put in movies now, and it's almost like, what's that word where you're desensitizing? That's not the word I'm thinking of, but you know, where you're growing accustomed to things and you're not as,
desensitizing, I think.
Yeah.
Desensitizing.
Like desensitizing our society. In other words,
you're removing your sensitivity to be bothered, I guess, by anything.
Yeah. And that's what this makes me think of, because this is really, really disturbing. And when you think about this fragment and when it was written, and that would have been like 100 and 150 AD, you know, that was probably terrifying. But then when you think about the millennials and the younger generations who are basically watching and exposing to these kind of TV shows, I mean, this, it looks like something that would be just completely made up. And you think, oh man, that's awful, but it's so real and very disturbing. So you've kind of explained how that connects to the Bible. And to kind of help clarify what you said earlier, this isn't actually part of the Bible. This is the Apocalypse of Peter, the Akmim fragment. And so I wanted to see if you could kind of explain, like, why would you read something like that? Like, what's the point of it?
For the first 100 years is pretty much the canon, because we have Christ was born, depending, I guess, on whatever position you take, it was either 6 BC or 3 BC, I believe it was. And Christ came, you know, into his ministry when he was around 30 years of age. Of course, his ministry was about 3 years, and then he was crucified. And then you have Paul, and you have the other apostles are doing their writings in around the AD 55 60, 65 in through there is where a lot of the books of the New Testament, you know, the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and the book of Acts, and 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, a lot of the, what we call the epistles, books of the Bible, were written at that time. And then you have John, who was the very last. He was the youngest of the disciples, but also the last one left. And I guess he lived to be up around, I guess we're assuming he died maybe somewhere around in the 90s AD. So you have the closure of that first century. But the problem is many of the other writers, other writings that they've tried to go in and say that they were scripture, were things that were written after that, like 150 AD or in the 200s. And they were written by a second generation of people. And they weren't always Christian people. I mean, some of those people were a representation of the Gnostic faith, and they took pretty much the idea of the Christian faith and put their own perversions to it. And so that's where a lot of those writings came from. And it wasn't until, I think, about the third century is when the Christian church began to canonize, you know, what books of the Bible do we accept and what books of the Bible do we not accept? And obviously, in looking at that, well, Revelation made the cut, but other books like the Apocalypse of Peter and so forth, those other books of the Bible didn't make the cut.
And we've talked a little bit about that before in season one, where we kind of talked about how the Bible was mostly focused around Jesus. Isn't that right? And that's kind of how we described how those chapters were selected into the Bible, was that it had to do with the life of Jesus.
Well, yeah, Christ is the center of that. And even the Christian acceptance of the Old Testament is pretty much the same way, because we believe, and there again, we're not in the same position of where Judaism or Islam, you know, the way their approach to their scriptures, but we believe that the books that are written in our Bible, all of them have futuristic prophecy that referred to Jesus, just like the book of Isaiah, for one example, in reference to, you know, the suffering Messiah, the suffering servant, reading through chapters and chapter 53 through maybe chapter 55. I'm just talking off the top of my head as far as the reference parts go. But we believe the Old Testament as it points to Jesus. We accept the New Testament because the New Testament is about Jesus.
I think that's a good way to look at that. And I'd say that that's a blessing, which kind of leads us into the blessing is declared by the book itself.
Going back to that first, what is it? The first three, I think, is it? That says, blessed is he who reads those words, hears those words of this prophecy, keeps these things that are written in, for the time is near. One should consider the possibility of being blessed every time they read the book of the Revelation. It's not something that you just sit down and read and, oh, I read that book and then you never go back to it. But it is something that it is, in fact, a revelation that God is revealing. And if we are living in the last days, then these are the signs of the times that we're looking at. Then I believe the book of the Revelation helps give us a clear understanding what that's going to look like. I mean, whether this happens in next year or whether it happens 1,000 years from now or 10,000 years from now, I don't know. But I think it seems very clear that there are going to be the nations that are in geographical location of in representing Russia and China and Asia and Iraq and Iran and all those nations, and especially some of those latter ones I mentioned that are always in opposition to Israel. that there is going to someday be a great and mighty battle that is going to take place, and it's going to be a world war, and it will be a war that will end all wars, and Christ will be the one who comes. And you may think of all of the military technology. In fact, I was reading some here just about a week ago. I think Israel is developing a laser system that is going to be shooting out missiles out of the sky.
Okay.
It just keeps going and going and going. And I don't know, maybe if we had better research and of our facts, in the sense of just being able to say, look at this article and look at this article and look at this article and look at this article, because there's so much, you know, out there. But I think the power of Christ coming back, a nuclear bomb is just not going to have any effect. I mean, it'll bounce off of the Son of God, it'll be just like the cartoons, you know, where you watch a Looney Tunes cartoon or whatever, and one of the characters hands a bomb to the other, and oh, it didn't go off, you know, and then they hand it back. This happened with Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote. If you've ever seen that cartoon, a lot of times the coyote, you know, is trying to blow up the Roadrunner, and, you know, he'll get a bomb and hands it to the bomb, and he hands it back, and the coyote's the one that always gets blown up. Well, imagine a full world war disaster, to where somebody handed God a bomb and God handed it back, and, you know, boom.
Yeah, there's no winning that.
That's all, folks.
End of episode.
Yeah. And then Porky Pig or whatever. I don't do a very good Porky Pig, you know.
But I think, entertainment aside, we still get frustrated trying to correlate the information learned by oneself against what is said by the experts. And there's a lot of experts out there. I mean, especially now, I think that's one of the big things with this pandemic, is all of a sudden there's all these experts and you can't get a real answer out of anything. I was talking to somebody at work about that today, where we were trying to figure out, how long are you supposed to wear a mask when you're quarantined? And when do you come back from work when you're quarantined with the positive testing? And I mean, and we had three different answers. Nobody can give, everybody's got to be an expert though. Everybody, that's like today's society. Everybody's an expert.
Well, it's kind of like, and there again, we're not taking any political party or political side or anything like that, but I know I've heard our president say at various times, you know, I follow the science. And I guess my next question after that is, well, what science? Because
yeah.
it depends on who you're reading, you know, or what medical journal, you know, you're believing or listening to, or whatever, you know. Follow the science. Well, what is it? What is the science?
Right. And I think that's a huge thing, is, you know, what we're getting ready to start this whole chapter in the Bible. And one of the biggest things is that this whole thing is a mystery. And it is probably one of the biggest mysteries that people have been trying to unwrap forever. And I think that's a great place to actually end this episode with the following questions for those of us that like to just spend some time thinking after this episode, or if you just want to answer on our social media. Just think, why do you think people are blessed by reading the book of the Revelation? And does the apocalypse of Peter present a worse description of torment than texts that are found in the Bible? And I'm going to kind of just even add on to that question. I mean, the apocalypse of Peter sounds really bad. And if you think about it from the time that it was written, it was probably terrifying. But now I think we could probably pull a Stephen King novel somewhere and find something way worse. And just think, you know, how much worse can it get before we are truly afraid?
You mentioned also that we've been desensitized in the idea of the shock effect. And I'll just share one example that just kind of came to my mind. But years ago, we were working in a church. This was, you know, before you were born, I'm sure. But anyway, my wife, Pamela, and I were leading a youth group, and there was a young man in the youth group that he knew all the scary films I mean, he'd seen them all, you know, Friday the 13th, and I forget what all the titles were that he even mentioned at the time. And I think he was into scary comic books. And this was even the time where video games were just starting to get developed, you know, technologies. And then people were having videos where they were owning movies. And it just seemed like that this young man, just there was nothing that was really able to move him. And stuff that he was watching and finding to be entertaining. I know my wife and I, if we watched it, we'd have been having nightmares for, you know, weeks probably, because scary movies is just not really something that we're really into. But as our culture begins to, as you begin to look at the generations of kids that have been born for the last 50 years, and the kinds of entertainment and the kind of exposure. I mean, all of that is just part of a big mess to where what shocks anybody nowadays? What's going to move you? And if you go back to like 100 years ago, 150 years ago, where you had have preachers, you know, that they would preach about Revelation, or they would preach about heaven and hell, and they could do it in such a way that people's hearts would melt and people would want to become Christians. Whereas in our day and age, if you got up and presented the same kind of sermon or illustration or whatever, people would just look at you like, duh, you know,
yeah.
They wouldn't get it. They wouldn't get it.
There's that scare tactic isn't even there anymore.
So that again is something that when you have to consider this book that we're looking at, some people will read it and they'll just be totally dead to it. Some people, it's not going to be exciting about it enough for them, you know. Well, it doesn't contain any sex, drugs, and rock and roll, so therefore, you know, what's it got to do with me? And it's talking about monsters and talking about vials being opened up and, you know, angels, and what does it all mean? I mean, it's a science fiction that it doesn't even meet a good description of science fiction when you think of what they're able to do today with, you know, Jurassic Park and I know that I'm even behind that. Well, how many Jurassic Parks have there been now?
Well, three, but now you're thinking Jurassic World, and I think there's another one coming out, so yeah. You're not that far behind.
Yeah, and I think there's a new Batman coming out too.
There is, yes.
Yeah, whole new Batman, whole new Superman. So all of this stuff is a whole lot darker, a whole lot more thought-provoking, a whole lot more moving, a whole lot more exciting. And you're going to, you know, give me this book of the Revelation.
Boring old history book.
Yeah.
That doesn't make any sense. I mean, that's probably the biggest thing that we'll start with this episode one. A lot of the stuff that we're going to say is not going to make any sense, and we have no answers.
Until it starts happening.
Yeah. But I think that's a good place to end. I mean, with that final question of what expectations do you have? I mean, as listening and starting this study, what expectations do you have when you know that this is not going to be as scary? It's going to be very confusing. So to our listeners, welcome to episode one, and we look forward to starting the actual book itself in the next episode.